Okay, so what's a typical day look like for you? You know, I mean, a typical 24-hour period, how much do you get achieved? If I sort of said, you know, if you fancy making, say, 420,000 quid in a day, would that be something that would appeal? Yeah? If I could introduce you to somebody who made £420,000 in a day as recently as August this year, would that be somebody you might want to listen to? I better bring him on stage then. Please welcome the man they call the realistic trader, Siam Kidd.
Lovely. Okay, so let's say I took you all to Heathrow right now, and we went out onto the apron and right into the cold, you know, jet fuel sort of smell, and I then held you all at gunpoint. And I'm about to force you to fly in one of two aircrafts, knowing that within the first 5 or 10 minutes of flight, you're going to have a total engine failure. So, the first aircraft is a lovely Embraer 190. It's the safest aircraft on record. It's never had a fatal crash. It's a fantastic aircraft, and we've probably flown in this quite a lot. The other candidate is a nice Robinson R22 helicopter. Nice piston engine there. It's had bucket loads of crashes, fatal, all over the world. People are crashing right now, especially in Australia with the farmers out there. So you're all at gunpoint and you have to choose one of them, knowing that the engine is going to fail. Which one would you pick? Sorry? Helicopter. Any other suggestions? So I'm forcing you by gunpoint here, don't forget. So you'd actually pick the helicopter? Plane? Okay. So that sort of ruined my example, because I was sort of expecting that most people would pick the Embraer. Well, if you did, you'd probably most likely die. And by the way, keeping all things equal here, you had the world's best Embraer pilot and the world's best helicopter pilot at the helm. Well, the thing is, if you were to go and try and get some information or advice, you go to, I don't know, flying instructor or whatnot, or the, you know, the aviation regulator, they would all probably recommend the Embraer because, you know, the stats, etc. And even if you thought the helicopter was safer, but you saw all of your friends and family going into this aircraft, you'd probably follow them. And that's exactly the same with the markets right now. The safest option would be the helicopter because there's a thing called auto-rotation. You basically glide down like a sycamore seed, and I could park the skids in a McDonald's car park and then go and get a Happy Meal afterwards. Whereas if you had a total engine failure in this, you need a pretty long, flat piece of ground, i.e. an airfield. And if you didn't have that, you'd end up in trouble. And you then have lots of people saying, oh, we didn't see that coming. And we have that all of the time. People said, oh, the 2008 crash, that came out of nowhere. That's absolute poppycock. There are so many people that did see it coming. So there's two things the main thing here is that people fear what they don't understand. And some people wouldn't even go near that helicopter just because they don't understand how it magically flies. And you need to educate yourself. So I know all of you here are well ahead of the curve already. Now, I really want to cover two points today, and I personally believe that we're in for one hell of an economic perfect storm. In fact, a lot of the things I'm going to say have already been said today. Harry Dent's presentation was phenomenal, and I think most of us here are singing off the same page. And a lot of people fear market crashes. It really divides people into two groups. There's one group of people that they fear them, hate them, loathe them. They put their head in the sand and hope it doesn't hurt them. And then you have another group of people which absolutely love market crashes, like myself. I've been dreaming of another stock market crash since 2008. I feel like a kid in Christmas at the moment, and I'm filling my boots. But the thing is, you shouldn't fear them. People fear what you don't understand, and people do not understand market crashes. These are good things. Crashes, they return overvalued assets to fair value. So you can then go in and buy things at good bargains. And also wherever there's disaster, there is immense opportunity. So personally, I'm absolutely loving what the future may hold. And I personally think Over the next 5 to 10 years, we're in for one hell of a rocky ride, and then after that, it's going to be economic awesomeness. I really do think technology is going to bring us out of, you know, the depths of wherever we go, because humans, we're clever. We always get around obstacles or problems. So, also there's one other thing I'd like just to mention here. Although I'm a currency trader, which is inherently short-term, I'm actually a long-term fundamental value investor. I really couldn't give a penny about, you know, all the short-term stuff. What's the FTSE going to do tomorrow? Or, you know, what market's going to go up or down because of interest rates or whatnot? I really don't care. I just see what's in front of me and I trade it. And all I do is I filter and I siphon off my excess profits that my trading gives, spins off, and I put them all into my long-term funds. Or long-term investments. And personally, I'm 97% of my own wealth is in physical silver, 1% in gold, and 2% in my trading account. I am all in on silver, or bullion, basically. But obviously, that wouldn't be recommended for you guys. It's just that I make it my mission to know exactly what's going on in the bullion world and the currency markets, etc. So, it all started, there's where I come from, I really think a lot of things really started from 1997, because there's a company called the Long Term Capital Management, and basically you got the cleverest mathematicians in the world, the cleverest hedge fund managers. They got together and thought, right, let's create a super fund. And then in 1997, the Thai baht had a bit of a crisis, which then rolled over into the Southeast Asia, and you had the Asian panic. And because of that Asian panic, we had then had the Russian ruble going tits up. Sorry, my language. And because of that Russian ruble crisis, that then killed LTCM. And out of nowhere, they went bust. It took 4 years for them to go bust. But from that Thai baht crisis, it took 1 year to kill the cleverest fund that has ever existed, or up until that time. And There's something which I need to give you a sort of a benchmark, because not many people really understand compounding interest or exponential growth, because we think in a linear sense. We understand 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, not 1, 2, 3, 4, 9 million, 8 billion, 10 quadrillion. We just don't get it. So for example, like compounding interest and exponential growth, they have the same math involved. So 1 million seconds is 11 and a half days. But any guesses, other than my students here, how long do you think a billion seconds is? 27, yeah, it's 32 years. But then a trillion seconds is 32,000 years. People really don't get that. You can't really talk about a millionaire and a billionaire in the same sentence. They're completely different animals. And so the thing with compounding interest is that 95% of the stuff happens in the last 5% of the time. And in some cases, I'd go as far as saying that 99% of the stuff happens in the last 1% of the time. And what I've seen is, even though I'm quite short-term with my trading, I do look at the big picture. And I don't trade from it, I just have it in the back of my mind. And everything that we're going through right now is in exponential growth. And it's absolutely fascinating. So if we, and we're seeing huge, major economic movements happening in such rapid fire time at the moment, it's like a machine gun going off. So I'm just going to start here with the US Federal Reserve pausing their QE. I won't talk too much about that, a lot of this has already been covered. We then have the Saudis driving oil down, because it's all about market share. The Saudis, they want to kill the shale industry, because they see it's taking tiny parts of their market share, so they're trying to kill the shale boys. And believe it or not, Saudi Arabia, even though they're the big boys, they need $104 a barrel oil just to balance their national budget. It's gone up. It used to be 77. It's now going up. And so they're, even though these guys are forcing oil down, they're now having to take massive loans and debts just to balance their books. So this, I mean, I personally see within sort of 18 months, maybe a year, we'll see $100 barrel oil again. This is only temporary. Also, we have all sorts of things going on, like the Swiss National Bank unpegging their franc to the euro. We've got QE, we've got euro just falling off a cliff at the moment. Literally every currency around the world that you can think of right now is experiencing massive lows. The yuan, the Chinese renminbi, they're constantly devaluing and lowering interest rates, or they've done it twice now. And there's all sorts of things going on. And the one thing which I think is rather interesting is Deutsche Bank. Harry said that Germany's in a bit of a tight squeeze, and well, I think it probably will get a lot worse, because Lehman Brothers, before they went bust, they were AAA, and then they got downgraded. I forgot the rating, I think it was like AA or A, I'm not quite sure. And it took 3 months from them to be downgraded for them to go bust. Deutsche Bank has just been downgraded to a lower level than what Lehman Brothers has been was downgraded to. So that's interesting. That happened about 3 months ago. I'm not saying that that's going to happen, but it's just interesting. There's so many things that are happening behind the scenes at the moment. And for the average person, you look at all of this and go, bloody hell, the world's going to die. We're going to forage in the woods for food, and it's going to be hell. And I personally really don't think that's going to happen. We may have financial Armageddon, but most people, the person on the street, won't really experience that much. Also, one other thing about, there is a big old time bomb going on in all sorts of things. The pension time bomb, the demographic time bomb, energy time bomb, there's all sorts of things going on. And also, when LTCM went bust, they needed to be bailed out by the banks. So all the banks had all this toxic debt from the LTCM debacle. And then Alan Greenspan, during the tech bubble crash, he lowered rates and started pumping loads of money, like currency, QE, etc., which then fueled the 2008 crash, because really when currency is printed, it goes really in two places, stocks and then property. So that's why they tend to be linked to a degree, not all the time though. And then 2008 happened, and all the banks needed bailing out. And so the Federal Reserve had to come in, the US Central Bank, and had to bail them out. So now all of this is a big chain, hopefully you can see, and all of this toxic debt is now being held within the central banks, who are part of the same cartel. That's why I said back when the Fed paused their QE, I said within 6 months, expect another central bank, a big one, to start QE. And lo and behold, the ECB did, I think within 3 or 4 months, because they're within the same group. Now, if you look at the Federal Reserve, they are insolvent on a mark-to-market basis. They're over-leveraged about 70 to 1. Most hedge funds are leveraged probably 5 to 1, depending where you go. So the next time we have a banking crisis, not if, it's when we have a banking crisis, who's going to bail out the Fed? And the only clear balance sheet we have on the planet right now is the IMF, the International Monetary Fund. They're leveraged about 3 to 1. They're the only entity out there that can bail anyone out. The government can't bail anyone out. They've got no money. So we may see capital controls and bail-ins like we saw in Cyprus and Greece, etc. We don't have time to go into it right now, but I do think within 10 years, the dollar will die, I lose its world reserve status, and we'll see the IMF SDR take its place. This stands for special drawing rights, so it's worth researching. I still haven't met a single economist that knows what an SDR is. So that's where I'm coming from. I see all of this happening, and I'm excited, because there's opportunity everywhere. Now, I was in a networking dinner not so long ago, and to be honest, it was really boring. And I started doodling on my little napkin. I was right in the corner, and no one could see me. And I was thinking, right, what am I going to do as things play out, or how do I personally see things playing out? And I started making some notes, and I thought, oh wow. I've created a bit of a timeline here. Now, I may not be right. I may be wrong. Who knows? But the thing with investing is that you need to leave pride, ego, and testosterone at the door. You mustn't. So many people are obsessed with being right. They make a view, and then they try and convince everyone, oh, I'm right, etc. Or trading and investing, it doesn't matter if you're wrong or right. The scoreboard is how much money, how much profit you make from your activities. So a good example was not so long ago, when oil was about $110, $120 a barrel, I said it's going to go up a bit, another $10, $20, etc. And then all of a sudden, oil just fell off a cliff. And then I remember one person go, oh, how's that oil trade going for you, Siam? Because I was going long. And I went, well, yeah, it's fine. I made 6% on that. And the instant I knew my stance was incorrect, I just flipped my position. And so I still made a lot of money out of being wrong, because you mustn't have pride. Now, I'm about to show you, I've typed it up for you. So I personally think it's just a matter of time before the Federal Reserve launches another round of QE. And when that happens, Eurodollar is going to go up. Stocks will go. This is all temporarily, by the way. Stocks will go up. I indices, this, you know, the FTSE, the S&P 500, etc. Aussie yen will go up. By the way, Aussie yen is quite interesting. It's the global canary of it's the canary of global risk. So when everyone's happy and singing and dancing, Aussie yen, the Australian dollar against the Japanese yen goes up. And when everyone's scared and really fearful, Aussie yen goes down. So it's like a risk indicator. So when QE comes in, all the naive investor goes, oh, free money, it's going to force everything up, Aussie yen also goes up. And then also expect more QE elsewhere, because when a country or a bank launches QE, it devalues that currency from, you know, so if the Fed does QE, the dollar's going to devalue slightly. And we are in a raging currency war right now. So other central banks will have to do that to protect exports. So that's what I'm expecting. If when the Fed launches QE, that's what I'll be doing. And if I'm wrong, I'll change my position pretty quickly. Now, this is the main thing, though. Go back in time and look at any major catastrophe, economic catastrophe, and you'll see it's most of the time, probably 80 to 90%, a black swan event of some sort, i.e. a bank going bust, terrorist strikes, a big company unpegging its currency from another currency, whatever. These things just come out of nowhere. No one can see them coming. It will happen. I don't care what form or state it's in. I know it will happen. And when I see that black swan coming, or happen, I will then react. And this is what may happen. If it's something war, terrorist related, oil may spike up. If war kicks off in the Middle East, which is it's getting quite scary over there, oil will be going up. Copper will then go down, because copper is a nice indicator of global consumption, really, and industry. And when market crashes happen, copper tends to go down. Look at copper right now. It's just fallen off a cliff. Stocks will then take a massive hit. Aussie yen will then go down. VIX will go up. VIX is the volatility index, otherwise known as the fear index. So it's like the Aussie yen, basically, but inversely related. And also gold and silver may go up. Obviously, it depends what's going to happen here. Long term, gold and silver, I always put my money where my mouth is. I never say anything and not put my money there. I think it's like disingenuous, really. So yeah, I'm all in bullion, as you know. So what then, as a result of all of this, we'll then have a global commerce will then dampen, which then has other domino effects. If global commerce dampens, like in 2008, we'll then see UK, I'm going to focus UK-wide here now, UK tax revenues will then decrease. And bear in mind, most major countries, their main income stream is tax revenue. So if global commerce dampens, that means not many people are, you know, exporting, importing, and dealing with each other. Our tax revenues, because our businesses will then start paying less tax because there's less sales going on, which will then hurt UK GDP and global GDP. So what does that then mean? Small businesses are going to get hit hard again, just like in 2007, 2008. And you always need to be wary of what politicians do. Politicians don't have a clue of the markets. Honestly, they have no clue whatsoever. No politicians here, right? No? I'll get off my high horse there. You have to worry, because politicians, their only button, really, whenever anything goes wrong, is print more currency. Just try and print our way. It's like a big old heroin dose. Just to try and relive the highs and prop things up. So do expect more QE. But also, there's a bit of a QE trap here. At some point, someone will launch around a QE. Everyone will then go, oh, look, stocks are just going to go up. But they won't. Because, as you know, confidence is everything. You can only print so much currency to the point where eventually that currency will just lose confidence with everyone. So stocks won't always go up when QE occurs, but do expect it. So you see, that's why whenever you look at a falling market, it does this, doesn't it? We call them dead cat bounces, and it's because of all sorts of other things, but mainly with human psychology. But yeah, eventually expect UK rates to stay low. Or, I mean, the government, the Bank of England got two levers, either print more currency or raise or lower interest rates. And 2007, they've used both, the they've lowered rates to zero, so they can't really do much. And they've printed loads, so they can't really do much more printing, so they're pretty screwed. So expect them to keep rates as low as possible, because a raise in rates will really hurt the nation. So we then have this pivot. So imagine, most of us here have credit cards, right? So obviously you can have a minimum interest repayment on your credit card. Now the UK national debt is, imagine it's like a credit card. The UK as a person has a credit card, and right now it's got about £1.8 trillion on it. To put that in perspective, if you earned £1 million every single day from the day baby Jesus was born, didn't spend it, you just saved it, until now, you'd need to live another 700-800 years before you hit £1 trillion. That's how crazy these big numbers are. It will never be repaid. The US national debt is about $19 trillion. It's crazy. But right now, we are struggling to pay the minimum interest repayments on our national debt, that $1.8 trillion debt, or $1.6, depending what source you look at. So this pivot, the moment this happens, because of all this dampening, the UK tax revenues will decrease, we will then go from AAA rating to Greece, like that. And people say, oh, rates won't go up that fast, the government and the Bank of England will do everything possible to, you know, stop the rise in rates that quickly. Well, they had the same mechanisms in Greece, and Greece went from like 4% to 23% in no time at all. So what will this, I mean, imagine a homeless person came up to you and said, will you lend me £10,000? Would you? No, you wouldn't, because you know that he has no means to repay his debt. And the UK will be exactly the same. We'll just turn into beggars. If we want to borrow more money to pay off our debts, well, people will lend us money, but at higher rates. It will then, base rates will be forced up. And what will that happen? What will the result of that? Is that rates will then start to rise, no matter what the bank or the government tries to do. Because, by the way, we live in a world where there's 96% more debt than actual money, and the global bond market controls the world, not politicians. And because with debt there's interest rates, and it's the bond market that controls interest rates. So rates will go up, and it's going to cripple the nation. Which means we'll see a massive increase in mortgage foreclosures, because a lot of people don't stress test their portfolio or even their own mortgage. Because let's say you have a £200,000 house or a £200,000 mortgage. For every 1%, and you're on a tracker rate, by the way, an SVR, standard variable rate mortgage. For every 1% UK base rates go up, your mortgage goes up about £120 per month. Now, I've spoken to a lot of people. By the way, don't forget, the 300-year average for UK rates is 7%, so that is the mean. And you all know markets are cyclical now. And markets, they don't just do that. Like a golf swing, they go back and forth. And the middle is 7%. Right now, we're at zero, pretty much. So it's not just going to do this, it's going to swing through. I personally think we're going to see double-digit rates again. And people forget, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s, we had double-digit rates. 1992 went up 5% in one day when the UK dropped out of the ERM, the exchange rate mechanism. So let's just say, there's one economist who said, oh, rates will never go up above 5%. And I said, okay, let's humour me. How high do you think they'll go realistically? And he said, oh, 3%. Well, let's do the maths. If rates go up 3% on a 200 grand mortgage, you'll have to pay an extra £360 a month, roughly, just to keep your house. Most families can't afford an extra £60 a month, let alone an extra £360 a month. So what will happen? A lot of people will just hand in their keys. They'll forsake their house. And the more houses that go up for sale, it'll then apply a negative pressure to house prices, and we'll see falling house prices eventually. And also be prepared to see these words a lot more in the press. Bail-ins, i.e. what happened in Cyprus, and capital controls, i.e. again in Cyprus and Greece, where they'll restrict the amount of money you can take out per day. You'll definitely see these in the papers. So yeah, eventually, I personally see a minimum of a 20% house price crash UK-wide. London, UK, wherever, everywhere in the UK, we'll see a big slump. And it's quite pleasing to see Harry Dent's research, because it does dovetail nicely into sort of wherever I've come from. So I've got to speed things up a bit. And also, riots. I won't say too much, but just they happen all the time. Now, one of the other reasons why I know, and I don't know, but why I think and why this may happen is because the only thing that remains constant in a world of changing variables is humans. Human nature never ever changes. That's why markets are cyclical. And this is the investor psychology, or the punter psychology. And it goes from contempt all the way to enthusiasm, everyone's copying their mates. And then eventually you find something which is like a 10-bagger, and you feel like Gordon Gekko. You really do feel like you're a god, a trading god or whatnot. And that's the dangerous part, because the trading, the horns of greed then pop up. And that's when you think you're invulnerable, and you start over-leveraging, placing bigger bets, trying to, you know, get far bigger returns, and that's where things really do go wrong. And then this is what happens to the rest of it. And people very quickly enter the denial and fear phase, and this is the longest phase. I know it looks like a bell curve here, but really it looks like this, and it's just a very long tail before you get back up here again. And then you get contempt, where you just want to burn things. Honestly, I remember like 6 years ago or something, I lost about 15 grand in under a minute once. Ruined my day. It was horrible. It's why my book is called The 15 Grand Pop-Tart, because I went downstairs to put some Pop-Tarts in the toaster, came back up, and I was, yeah, and I felt like this guy. Where he hurt his foot kicking that thing. yeah, so by the way, I'm nothing special. I've been trading for about 12 years now. I'm an average bloke from Norwich with distinctly average qualities. And yeah, I've just got 12 years of mistakes under my belt. And the first 6 years of trading, I've lost more money than probably all of you combined. I'm just weathered. But as I said, every cloud has a silver lining whenever you see doom and gloom. I don't want to see that much doom, though, because that would be quite horrendous. And so that's where trading comes in. That's why I love trading. And if you ever do, and I personally believe, I mean, it's completely changed my life, which is why I think so many people do need to at least know a little bit about trading, because people, they fear it, they hate it. They're like, oh, you're like a demon in person. Honestly, I get so much hate sometimes. But even if you learn how to trade just to profit from market crashes, it's a life skill. And if you do learn to trade, you need to do it correctly. Do not day trade. Day trading is the devil. That's where you're spending 1 to 8 hours a day staring at your screen or screens, placing God knows how many trades, growing gray hair, losing loads of money. And that's why I lost so much money in the first 6 years of trading, because I was day trading. And really, if you're spending more than 5 minutes a day trading, you're doing something wrong. A lot of my hands up who are realistic trader students here. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, the Norwich contingent over here. Yeah, Andy. Yeah, some of you have seen that my market analysis every day, less than 2 minutes a day, really. Once I do my 2 minutes, I then turn it off and I get on with the rest of my day. And that's the only way it's sustainable. So I'd like to quickly introduce you to pounds per points. So the way that we trade is that I don't own a thing. I don't own any stocks. I wouldn't want to right now. Just because I personally believe we're going to have another huge crash. In fact, in 2013, I made a documentary called How to Profit from the Crash of 2016. I put my head up, head on the parapet, and everything I said in that documentary has come true. And earlier this year, I said, expect October 2015 to see the first domino starting to fall. I was wrong by a couple of months. It was 24th of August, Black Monday. So I do think 2016 is going to be awesome. I can't wait. I don't own anything, and so I trade the movement of the market. So imagine going to the horses, right? And you see a horse, Lucky Jimmy, and you bet on that horse to win. When that horse wins, you make money, but you don't own the horse, do you? You've made money on the movement of that horse, and that's all I do. So imagine you go to your local betting shop. I think we all know that's Ladbrokes, but and you go up to the checkout, and let's say you look at the FTSE. Let's speed this up a bit. And right now, let's say the FTSE's at 6,300. What you can then do is go long at, say, £10 a point. So going long basically means that you think it's going to go up. And so for every point it goes up, you make £10. So if it goes from 6300 to 6301, you've made 1 point. Now let's say you're correct in your trade, and then the market goes up to 6400. How many points have you made? 100, yeah. so you made 100 points, and at £10 a point, you made £1,000 tax-free profits. Every single penny of my trading, all the profits anyway, is tax-free. It's beautiful. Now, this is why owning stocks and shares, I personally think, is so 1990s. It's got so much, you've got capital gains tax you have to pay, commissions, stamp duty tax, and you can only make money when the stock goes up. Gone are the days where things just go up. So, and if you want to, if you saw this crash, the only way you could sort of protect yourself is to go to cash, which I agree with a lot of people that said that today. But you're not profiting from it, you're just stepping out of the firefight and waiting till things get to fair value again. But the way that we trade, you can actually profit from it. That's why I'm so happy right now. So you could say, right, I think the FTSE is now going to fall, so I can short the market. Shorting basically means you think it's going to go down. So you could place the same bet. I hate using the word bet and gambling because it's nothing like gambling. so let's say you're right, and it does go down, and it goes to 6,200. You've now made 200 points. And at £10 a point, £2,000 tax-free. So that's how you profit from stuff. And I don't own a single stock or share. So let's say, here's the FTSE. I'll use this screen as well, sorry. So this is the FTSE from sort of 2000 to 1998, etc. And as you can see, we've got the tech bubble crash over here, with the 2000 high, we then have the 2007 high over here. And right now, we're hovering pretty much at the same highs. We had that high in 2015, I think it was April. And right now, we're hovering around here. We've had that big old dip. Now, let's just say, after everything you've heard from today, you also believe that the market's going to take a bit of a tumble. And you thought, right, okay, the market's going to fall. And personally, I think the FTSE, we will see within 5 years, the FTSE going down to sort of the 3,500 level. Easy. And that's if, forgetting that, don't forget, markets always overcompensate, or they tend to. But I think 3,500 is a fair assumption. Again, I may be wrong, but I'll trade it if I am wrong. So what you could do is you could say to yourself, right, I'm going to take the view it's going to go down, and I want to profit from it like crazy. So let's zoom in a bit. So here we got the still same chart, I've just zoomed in a bit. Here's that high. So you could go short on the market, and you have to be very careful. A lot of people, they go, right, I think it's going to go down, and they place a trade right where the market is, right there. And that's a bit risky, because you don't know that the market's going to fall like that. And so a lot of people will place a trade there, and they could get burnt if the market then goes up. So the way I trade is all I'm looking for is the low-risk, high-probability outcome trades where I know I'm 90% positive it's going to go in my favor. So all I do when I trade, my 2 minutes of trading a day, is I'm putting out my fishing lines in the market, or my booby traps, whatever you want, and I then sit back and wait to which fish bite my lines. And when I see a line being bitten, I then reel it in. So what I would do here, and what I've done on my personal account and my fund, I run a trading fund, is that you can put these fishing lines out, and they're called entry orders. They're free, you can place as many of them as you want, and it's beautiful. So the better place, the safer place to do is put your fishing line below this level over here. Now there's a thing called support and resistance levels, we don't have time to talk about that today, but here would be a good-ish place to put your entry sell order. So what this means is that you could place this and then forget about it. And then you could be on a hammock in Hawaii on holiday, and you look at the papers and go, oh, the markets are tumbling, and you'll know that you're in profit. These are like your stock market crash seatbelts. Because what happens is that, you already predetermine your stop losses and whatnot, and how big the trade you want. But let's say the market then starts to go down. Well, at this point here, the second the market touches this level, let's say you put it around the 5,700 level, your trade is now active. And you don't even need to be at the screen. You don't even need to be in the country. And then what you do is you then let it run. One of the things that you need to remember is that you need to let your trades run and cut your losses short. Whereas most people do the opposite. They keep their losses running and they cut their profits short. Yeah, and then you can let it play. So that's one of the things I'm going to do. And yes, you will see massive volatility when things like this happen. You'll see, I mean, this could be a result of QE or whatnot, or whatever politicians tried to do to muddle the way out of it. But eventually, once it gets down here, you could close the trade, let's say, and you can make that automatic. So when the market hits 3,500, it closes it, whether you're at your screens or not. And let's say, and if you went short around from here to here, that's roughly 2,000 points. So at £10 a point, that's 20 grand tax-free. And if you do that every market crash, every 10 years or so, every 18 months, we have a sort of at least a 10% correction of some sort, but every 10 years, we do have some sort of calamity. It is a life skill. Again, this is oil. Again, you don't need to take a view. I don't know whether oil is going to go up or down, but I think it's going to go up, so you could place an entry order above the highs to try and catch it if it goes up. But again, you could straddle the market. I don't know if it's going to go up or down, so I could put an entry sell order there. But what I do know is that at some point in my life, oil is going to go either up here or down here. It's just markets. I don't need to waste precious brain power reading the papers, watching the news. I just do what the charts tell me. So this is how I consistently profit from most major market moves. I consider myself, my fund, a sort of a black swan fund. So if we have a year where absolutely nothing happens and we have a really boring year, I tend to make 10 to 20%. But when stuff happens, as I said, I fill my boots. So when the US pulls a QE, I made 7% in like 3 weeks. When crude oil crashed, I made 6%. When the Swiss franc unpaid from the euro, I made 18%. Then when the ECB launched their QE, we made another 15%. And then on Black Monday, we made 30% ROI, or 30.32%, which is awesome. Honestly, I was the most stressful person in the in the world that day. I was in my underwear and my dressing gown, and I was just shouting down the corridors to Ellie. I was like, 100 grand up, 200 grand up, 300, and she was like, snatch. Snatching means I take profits, but yeah. So, yeah, that was a fun day. And it's, oh no, I included a screenshot of my report, but hasn't come up. But if anyone wants it, I can show you my reports. But but the important thing here is that you don't need to predict the markets. You can very easily capitalize on pretty much whatever the market does, as long as your risk management is there. Risk management is so, so important. And the way that I trade is that I can lose 14 trades out of 15 and still make money. And I mean, if you look on the internet, they say risk 1% per trade. So if you have, say, a 5 grand account and you place a trade, you need to risk no more than £50. I personally risk 0.1% per trade. Because I know that I will have losing streaks, everyone does, but the way I trade is I could lose 40 trades in a row and still be all right, and only be a percent or two down. So it's all about, profits is really just a bonus. Capital preservation is key. You need to treat your capital like it's your only kidney and protect it against everything. Profits is just something that comes if you just stick to your rules. So sorry for running over a little bit, Graham, but that's it, and happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Slayer. No.